But you know, we have a warning from Ezekiel, the third chapter, about warning the people. If we don't warn them, their blood's going to be on our hands.
The blood will be on our hands. So Judith, you know, the thing about it is, your attitude, you're going to be judged by God. You will stand before the Lord, and if you know the truth and you don't tell it, blood will be upon your hands and our hands as well. And you need to rethink your position. And I can understand from a woman's point of view how repulsive that would be. But still, we've got to know.
Well, especially because these laws, if Sharia comes in, these laws will be binding on non-Muslims also. Let me read this. It also regulates the governing of all Islamic state and its relations to non-Muslims within the state, as well as to enemies outside the state. So Sharia law can be, and later on there's a section where I actually talk about how it affects non-Muslims. But if Sharia law comes in, then all of a sudden the women will have to wear the burqas. All of a sudden our dealings with the banks will have to change. Everything will have to change.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Now, three main sections, the faith. And my Arabic is not, I'm not an Arabic at all. So akidah, ethics, akhlaq, and the acts of a Muslim. So basically into three sections, the ethics, the faith, and the actual living. Now, the acts of a Muslim is divided into three sections. The prayer, the salah, talks about the ritual purification, the wudu, the fast, which is Psalm and Ramadan. And the fast, we talked about this before. The fast is an interesting fast. You don't eat during daytime hours,
mm-hmm.
but you eat at night.
Yeah.
So to me, it's just a postponement of dinner.
Right. Linda writes in, said, I've worked in the Indiana prison system, and Islam is spreading like wildfire. And that is correct. One of the greatest areas of growth for Islam is in American prisons. However, we want to make clear that for the vast majority of Islam that is growing in American prison system, it's not the Islam. It's
right.
It is the Black Muslim Brotherhood.
The Nation of Islam.
Nation of Islam, led by Louis Farrakhan.
Right.
Which they differ greatly in some aspects of interpretation.
There's a mutual agreement to accept each other, but in reality, they do so just for public purposes,
right,
because the differences are so vast between Nation of Islam and Islam.
And she says the inmates do wash their hands there first and pray on rugs. I've seen it myself, and you cannot change their minds.
It's on the increase. It's on the go. Okay, so we also have charities, the zakat, and the pilgrimage to Mecca, which is Hajj. What you're seeing here, this picture here, this is where the black stone is, and these people will actually be running around in a circle around this.
How do they keep from stampeding one another?
It's interesting. I've seen a video of it. It's really interesting. They I guess they got a set rhythm that they've got to go through. But this is something that the pilgrimage to Mecca, once in a Muslim's life, if he could afford it.
Now, let me ask this question. You got charities down there. You know, I've traveled all over the world, and I have been in some of those trips have been in disaster zones, and we brought food, medical supplies, or paid for it, had a ship that had to be there for. And I'm not being unkind, but I've never seen Islam exhibit any act of charity in a disaster zone, even among its own. I can remember in the Sudan, which is a Muslim country, and traveling out of from Khartoum,
right,
and into some villages that were Muslim, that were starving. It was during the famine that gripped Africa in the 80s, and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of Africans died of starvation. The vast majority of them were Muslim. And I remember that one area that we brought food to and medical supplies was all Muslim. And I remember Dad asking the chief, the spokesman of the village, who was the chief, what has Islam done for you during this time? And he said, absolutely nothing. There's been no help of food, medicine, or whatever the case. Now, I'm not saying that's the case everywhere, but I'm just saying that in every natural disaster or whatever of in Africa that I've been to that was Muslim, it was always United States, Canada, Australia, and countries like that that were providing aid, and religious organizations that were providing help. Never once did I see boxes, and many times we were there with other relief agencies. And so you would see on the box, you know, a gift from Australia, a gift from the Red Cross. You never saw anywhere a gift from Saudi Arabia or Iran or Iraq or Pakistan. Yeah, yeah. You know, you never saw that.
Well, here's, first of all, the Quran is fairly quiet about this. There are eight categories which can receive the zakat. And the first one is those living in absolute poverty. The next one is those who cannot meet their basic needs. The third is the zakat collector themselves. So I know when I read that, I go, oh my goodness. Non-Muslims who are sympathetic to Islam and wish to convert, money can be used for that. Okay, so we use for the evangelism of the infidels. Mm-hmm. Those who incur overwhelming debts while attempting to satisfy their basic needs. The working of an Islamic cause. Well, so any cause that is Islamic can receive the money.
Yeah, but that. Before we go further, you know, you mentioned three times poverty, those right. in poverty. But yet, by the United Nations' own reckoning, the vast majority of Muslims in Saudi Arabia, one of the supposed richest countries in the world, live below the poverty level. The sheikhs and the oil barons are multi billionaires,
right?
But the vast majority of the citizens of Saudi Arabia right. live below the poverty level. So where is the charity to their own people?
But you understand, it could also be given to an Islamic cause.
Yes.
And what would an Islamic cause be?
Jihad. That's why the government, and for the last 10 years, have been closely monitoring so-called Muslim charities, because so many of them were fronts.
That's right.
To raise money to furnish into terrorist organizations.
Now, many Muslim scholars, I had mentioned the fact that it can be used to help non-Muslims. But many today argue that point and say, no, it should be. Now, it could not also, one of the other conditions was it could not be given to any relative of Muhammad. So somebody who's a descendant of Muhammad could not have the zakat. And the last one was a traveler in need.
There is an Islamic charity.com, and I'm looking at it right now on my computer. And everything that there, it's just a small page, and everything there is dealing with Islamic countries and Islamic people.
That's right.
Chris writes, could you please explain when Islam came about and if any other religions came about from the split? In other words, are there any offshoots from it? And of course, the answer to that is yes, because you've got the Sharia.
Well, Sharia and Shia Sharia, come from
Sunni and Shia.
But they both consider themselves as Muslims.
Yes, but there are two.
Right.
Their one is much more militant and aggressive than the other.
Right, right.
The Sunnis are the more peaceful, am I right?
I had it last week. I got to try to find
it. But when did Islam, what was the time frame? He wants to know.
It was like
7th century, 6th
century. Well, 620, 630, that time period.
But the Nation of Islam is an offshoot here in America. We just mentioned that a few minutes ago. That's an offshoot.
Baha'i faith is also another one.
Baha'i?
Yeah, Baha'i is, if I'm not mistaken.
I thought that was the Eastern splinter off of Hinduism.
Let me check on that, but I thought for a second it was one of the Muslims that had broken off from that. All right, human interaction or al-amu'amalat, financial transactions covered by the Sharia law, endowments, laws of inheritance, marriage, divorce, and child care, foods and drinks, the penal punishments, warfare and peace, and the judicial matters.
Now, what do you mean by foods and drinks?
Well, what foods you're allowed to eat, which is halal and which is not halal. When we get into the next slide covers alcohol, for example.
Okay.
Let's go to that. This is under the website that we had on Islam. This is their laws. All alcoholic liquors and beverages which intoxicate a person are najis. And najis means unclean. It's not, you're not allowed to do it. and on the basis of recommended precaution, everything which is originally liquid and is intoxicants, a person is not najis. Hence, narcotics like opium and hemp, which are not liquid originally, are pot. Pot means it's good, it's acceptable. Even when a liquid is added to them.
Well, you know, that's very interesting. The one of the times, Mike, that I was in London on business, when we were buying some particular equipment that was made in England, and we had to go verify, check on it. It was during, I was staying in London at the same time that OPEC was meeting, which is the Arab.
Yeah.
And I was staying, they were, some of them were in my hotel, but they were staying in the area of London. They were situated in the hotels in that part of London. Right. Now, most of them were about a half a mile down the road where there was a conglomerate of super exclusive five-star hotels, and not the Hilton.
Right.
And I'm talking about super expensive. And it was, and when I've traveled to a foreign country, if they have an English language newspaper, I always read it. I want to know what's going on. Of course, London is English speaking. And I was reading the London Times and the Telegraph and all of that. And one of the stories was after OPEC, they were quoting the hotel managers on the habits of these Islamic
visitors. Yeah.
And they said that when they come into town, they serve more liquor. They said they have more problems with prostitution, them trying to bring in prostitutes. They have more problems with all these things. And the answer when confronted was that, well, is England and London is not a Muslim territory. Therefore, what we do on its soil is not considered against the Quran.
Oh, my goodness.
That was the answer of one of the sheikhs.
Yeah. There's a lot of loopholes that I found.
Yes.
A lot of loopholes. For example, the aspect of going out and having sexual affairs or fornication. Well, all you do is you go into that temporary marriage with them.
Well, what did we find about the guys of 9/11? When they tracked their movements before they took over those planes, part of a group of them, part of their time was spent at a strip club.
Yeah.
You know, drinking, smoking.
So coming against America for our wickedness and yet participating in the same sin.
And then it was covered, but it was not made a big deal out of by the American media that during, you know, the Iraqi war. And I saw the interview of one of the I don't know if he was still an Army or Marine, I don't remember, but he was a spokesman for that segment branch of the military, and they were asking what was been one of the surprises. And he said, the shock has been, I thought, he said, we were told that so many things were sins to Muslim that we would, you know, alcohol, cigarettes, pornography. He said, but when we clean out houses, he said, the whiskey, the pornography is staggering.